So let's all start by getting into a space of meditation, getting into our heart spaces. So let's find a seated position. Find stillness of the body. Allow the breath to deepen. Stillness of the body bringing us stillness of the mind. Internalizing the senses. Becoming aware of the sacred heart space about 1 centimeter to the right of the center of the chest. So that we can listen from this space, process what we're hearing from this space, that already knows all of this information. Once it is heard from this space, it can be integrated immediately. We can share from this space as well. Again, I'd like to ask for everyone, if you could, to please write your questions into the chat. And after the first 30 minutes or so, we'll go into the questions. And now from this space. Let's start our chat. I'll share my screen. So we were here last time. This is where we ended. We were talking about the development of the chakra system as we grow to become an adult. So when we have this normal development, we have a fully functioning system by the age of about 18, where the crown through the root is all activated. And from there, we get the activation of the Earth Star Chakra below the feet. That Earth Star Chakra activates what we call the Kundalini energy, which exists at the Muladhara. And again, everybody has this Kundalini energy always. You wouldn't be alive if you didn't have this life force flowing through you constantly. But when this Earth Star Chakra activates and when the chakras that are above the Sahasrara start activating in alignment with the heart, then we get an activation of this Kundalini energy in the root, a further activation of it as it unwinds around the root chakra and further activates not just the chakras above the head, but also further activates the base 7 chakras as well. So as the chakras above the head are activating, so do the base 7 chakras activate to an even higher degree. And we'll go through this. So we'll start with the root chakra, going into some common developmental issues that happen and understanding, a basic understanding of the first 7 chakras. We'll go through them one by one. We'll start with the root chakra, which we have the element of earth that is connected to this root chakra. And this element of earth and the root, the Muladhara, as it's called, is connected to the energy of survival, the physical health of the body. So vitality, the feeling of vitality, of security. So when the energies in this chakra are out of alignment, we can either have an overactivation of this chakra or an underactivation of this chakra. when we have an underactivation of this chakra, that can lead to feelings of insecurity, feelings of difficulty just surviving or getting a home, feeling at home in your body, in your physical body. It can lead to a lack of physical health, a lack of vitality, which can cause for difficulty in maintaining weight. It can cause for difficulty in sleeping, frequent illness, chronic pain, sciatica, back pain, a difficulty concentrating or focusing due to this pain, and an excess activation of this chakra, which can also happen, can lead to obesity. It can lead to too much sleep, deep, deep insecurities, as well as overly rigid boundaries and a fear of change. So this Muladhara chakra is a very important chakra to be able to just feel secure in your body and have good physical health. And then we come to the second chakra, the sacral chakra. This is connected to the element of water and related to our emotional health, the watery energy of our creativity, our sensuality, our sexuality, the pleasure that we feel. And again, we can have either an underactivation of this chakra or an overactivation of this chakra. And underactivation of this chakra can lead to rigidity in the body, feeling very cold, a lack of energy in general, a lack of excitement or enthusiasm, as well as a fear of change. And an overactivation of this chakra can lead to various addictions, dependencies on various external substances or people or whatever sort of external addictions that people can use to depend on to activate this chakra. So oftentimes that can be drug addictions. It can lead to a lack of, or sexual addictions even as well. So it can lead to a lack of emotional control as well as obsessive compulsiveness and oversensitivity. We come up to the solar chakra, the Manipura chakra, where we have the element of fire that is coming through this chakra. This is how it connects us to that fire within us. Here is often where that sense of the ego identity, of course, we have the ego identity everywhere often, but our sense of willpower, our well-being and confidence comes from this place. So often a lot of the ego identity is stored here. And again, we can have an underactivation or an overactivation of this chakra. So when we have an underactivation of the chakra, we can have just a low energy, a lack of fire, a lack of drive, right? A lack of decisiveness or discipline or ability to get things done, right? A lack of confidence or self-respect. A lack of self-respect can also lead to a lack of respecting others, because how can you respect others when you cannot respect yourself? Yeah, it can lead to this victim mindset where we're often blaming others for our problems or whatever in our life we are blaming others for. It can often come from this imbalance in this chakra. And this chakra is also related to our digestive capabilities. So an inability to digest food, as well as a other sorts of complications, including diabetes and issues with the pancreas, with the liver and the gallbladder, often can come from an imbalance in this chakra. An excess energy in this chakra can often lead to frustration or anger. Anger, again, which is said to be stored in the liver. Aggression, a need to control or obsessively controlling the outcome of things, a stubbornness and a hyperactivity of the mind, an over-competitiveness, a need to be right about everything. So a lack of humility, really. Then we come up to our heart chakra, where we connect to the element of air, right? They say, what? Love is in the air. Yeah. So this is the heart chakra. It is connected to our social identity and our ability to give and receive love. Our ability to have compassion, not only for ourselves, but also for others. Again, just like with our victim mindset and with our decisiveness and with our confidence, right? We, in the heart chakra, if we are not able to have compassion for ourselves, how can we have compassion for others, right? So this self-compassion leads to this peace and this feeling of acceptance that is also coming from a balance in our heart chakra, the ability to, again, give and receive love. Deficiency in this chakra, so an underactivity of this chakra can lead to depression. It can lead to even physical illnesses like asthma and difficulty with breathing. Yes, and inability to connect with others can also come from this, so sort of feeling too withdrawn, a lack of self-acceptance, being too judgmental, again, not just of yourself, but of others, as well as a lack of empathy and narcissism can come from a deficiency in this chakra, a lack of opening of this heart. An excess in this chakra can lead to the a desire to almost sacrifice yourself for others needlessly, a jealousy, a clinging and a codependency, to depending on others for feeling love, poor boundaries, and feeling demanding of others, almost like a entitlement, feeling entitled to the love of others can come from an excess in this chakra. So then we come up to the throat chakra, the Vishuddha, where this is connected. I didn't write this down, but this throat chakra is connected to the element of space, ether. So this is the fifth element, and this element is sort of a combination of all the other four elements. And it is our ability to express ourselves. It's also our ability to hear. So for example, even when we're dreaming, when we're remembering our dream, if you can hear in your dream, that means your throat chakra is open. If you can't remember, let's say, what you're hearing in your dreams, there's probably maybe a deficiency in the openness of your throat chakra. This is connected to our ability, again, to hear our intuition. That's why this hearing comes from this throat chakra, our ability to hear, to listen properly, as well as to communicate properly from the heart space. This is our throat chakra. And when it's balanced, we can not only communicate from our heart space, but we can hear our heart's guidance. We can listen to our intuition properly when this throat chakra is balanced and open. So again, this throat chakra can be either have a lack or it can have an excess. And when there's a deficiency in this chakra, we can have a difficulty expressing ourselves from the heart. There can be almost, it can come up and then we shove it back down. It can come up and then we shove it back down. And so there can be that fear of speaking. There can be, again, what we call shyness or introvertedness, which is just something we can untrain this. You know, people say, oh, I'm an introvert. You don't have to be identified with that. It's something that you can change. You can change it through practice, through opening this throat chakra and practicing, expressing yourself from the heart, rather than being really secretive about what you're feeling. Yes? So an excess in this chakra can make it difficult to listen to others. You can have a tendency to speak over others or to gossip too much, even stuttering or interrupting others in conversation can come from this excess of the Vishuddha chakra, talking loudly and appropriately, what's that called? Yeah, that there's a condition where you cannot control what you're speaking. Someone can probably jump in and tell me what that's called. It's blank, for some reason, blanking on it. Anyway, let's move on.
Tourette's?
Yes, Tourette's. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, Tourette's syndrome is an example of large excess in the Vishuddha chakra, where there's so much energy going through, but there's also like a desire to squelch that. And so then it's like energy building up in a dam, and then it just comes out and it bursts out, and then you squelch it again. So it's sort of like a bipolar issue that's coming from the throat chakra. Anyway, we'll come back up to the third eye now, the Ajna chakra, or Ajna chakra, depending on how you pronounce. So this is our ability to focus our intention, to have that single-pointed focus, which allows for proper manifestation. If we cannot visualize properly what it is that we want to create from the heart, we cannot create it. It also allows for proper dream recall. If you can remember your dreams, right? If you can remember what people call your past lives, right? Then this means that it is very likely your third eye is quite open. It helps with the ability to focus, to have clear thoughts, to be able to see your thoughts, and to efficiently manifest what it is that you are visualizing and imagining. When this third eye is blocked, it can be physically blocked, or there can be mental or emotional blockages or spiritual blockage. And this, again, can have a deficiency or an excess. We have a deficiency in this Ajna chakra. There can be a lack of vision, a lack of imagination, very rigid thinking, again, a difficulty recalling dreams or seeing from the perspective of others, the ability to change your perspective. If you're locked into one solid perspective and you really just think you're right about everything, that can be a block in the third eye. Your inability to see from the perspective of others. If you can step into the shoes of others and see from them and shift your perspective easily, you're likely to have a well-functioning third eye. Again, if there's an excess in this, you can get issues like migraines, headaches, difficulty concentrating, delusional thinking, nightmares, difficulty controlling your thoughts. Nightmares come from that inability to control your thoughts. Yes? Even a difficulty in controlling your vibration, right? And obsession, obsessive thinking, compulsive thinking, as well as neurological and learning issues, memory issues. And then we come to the crown, Sahasrara, where we have the connection to the universal identity, the chakras that are above Sahasrara connect to the heart through this crown, right? So here we have in the crown our belief system, which is, again, the belief system goes above the Sahasrara, but this is the connection to the belief system. This connects us to self-knowledge, to our wisdom and our bliss body. So if there's a deficiency or an excess, again, that deficiency can lead to a very materialistic focus, an inability to see your true self, and a tendency to identify with the physical structure, the physical body, and believe that this is you, right? A lack of discernment, ability, which is the ability to, in the moment, decide what is right and what is wrong for you right now. Because what is right and what is wrong is not always the same for everyone in every moment. What is right and what is wrong can always be different for individuals, depending on the circumstances and what's happening right now. So, for example, some people in terms of what food they're eating, for example, even as simple as that. You know, some people may need to eat less carbohydrates. Some people need to eat more carbohydrates. I mean, let's keep it as simple as that, right? If you can discern what your body needs, that is one right now. Again, that's different depending on the individual. Yeah. So not everybody needs to be eating the same way. That's why it's so difficult using science, really, to say, oh, this is healthy and this is not, right? Because what is healthy to one may be unhealthy to another. And that's just how reality works. So if there's a rigid belief system, cynicism, apathy, this can also be a lack of bliss, a lack of this Sahasrara energy. An excess in this can be a tendency to over-spiritualize and disconnect from the body, a tendency to leave your body, which can lead to physical, emotional, and mental complications in terms of dissociating with the body and the mind and inability to stay grounded in your physical structure. And inconsistency, spiritual imbalance, even a highly disconnected or excess of this crown chakra can lead to issues like bipolar or even schizophrenia. So it's important to remember to stay grounded. And this is where the Earth Star Chakra comes into play, which is our connection to the planet, our ability to remain grounded. And the Earth Star Chakra is what exists below the feet. And it's what's important is that as we're opening those chakras that are above the crown, we also open the Earth Star Chakra below the feet to balance out those energies so that we don't get dissociated and we're able to stay grounded in our bodies. Because that's what we came to this planet for. We didn't come to this planet to leave our bodies. We came to this planet to actually ground those higher energies through this body into the planet. That's why we're here. So many individuals are unfortunately a little bit stuck on the first three chakras or stuck on the top three chakras, right? Some people can be overly materialistic or overly focused on the physical. And some people can be overly spiritual and way too focused on the spiritual, and they can be completely ungrounded. And it's very difficult in either of those imbalances to actually manifest. So balance is key, and that's where the heart center comes into play. That's why I always focus on the heart center. That is where we expand into always in order to remain balanced between the physical and the spiritual. So how the chakras activate? Again, I always emphasize this sacred heart space. That's point that's about a centimeter to the right of the center of the chest, because this is the space that we go into, the space of unconditional love and gratitude and appreciation. That is our foundation. This is the foundation. It's not below the feet. It's not above the head. It's not in the spiritual world that we are founded, and it's not in the physical world that we're founded. We're founded in the heart space, in that unconditional love. And when we are actually have a strong foundation there, and we're strongly grounded in that heart space, and then we can process immediately all the karma that we're experiencing. All the karma is immediately processed. And that's, well, it's sort of an end goal, but we move there in stages. So we start off by really believing that we are our physical body, and that's sort of a normal thing to believe at first, that you are your physical body, and often a child will believe that. And then we move up in stages consciously as the chakras activate. And we have these different lifestyles. One is called the ascetic lifestyle. And this is where we're sort of pulling back into ourself, sort of pulling back from society in general in order to understand ourselves. And this is what many had to do in the past, especially because the vibration of the society was at such a low level in the past that it was necessary really to pull out of that society in order to understand oneself. And that's why typically people would either, you know, go to the mountains by themselves and live the lifestyle of an ascetic in order to get to know oneself, because then nature would come and teach you who you are, right? Then we get to the lifestyle of a mystic, and this is someone that already knows who they are, and they're, what they're doing is they're coming back into society with that knowingness of who they are, and they're playing life. So they've realized you don't need to escape life like an ascetic. That's just a step, right? It's a step towards self-knowledge. Once you know who you are, there's another step, and that is to re-come into society, to bring others into the fold. Yes, and that's the life of a mystic. People like Amma or Sadhguru or many of these people are living the lifestyles of a mystic, where they have that self-knowledge, and what they're doing is staying grounded in that heart space and simply being themselves, expressing themselves in an original way with an original language. And that's the life of a mystic. So in order to understand and actually visualize how the chakras activate, we have this concept of cymatics, which teaches us not only how the chakras activate, but how consciousness itself grows. How the consciousness not only of the individual, but also of the society in general, of not only the individual soul, but of the oversoul. How does it evolve? And we can visualize this using this process of cymatics. I want to share with you a little video. It's a short video. All right, so as you can see, what happens as the frequency of the tone is turned up, we move through periods of chaos in order to find higher orders of harmonic resonance patterns that keep increasing in their complexity. And this is what happens not only on the individual scale with our own chakra system as the frequency of the body and the mind are turned up, the complexity of the chakra system shifts and changes. Again, it goes through periods of chaos and then reaches a higher order of an equilibrium state and where there is a harmonic resonance pattern. We find that harmonic resonance pattern, and then in order to get to the next harmonic resonance pattern, we have to move back into that chaos. You can see even societally with what's happening around us, clearly we're moving through a period of chaos societally. And this is normal. As evolution happens, we must move through this period of chaos to find a higher order of societal harmonic resonance. And this is simply the consciousness of our society in its totality that's increasing in its frequency. We're seeing it happen before us in slow motion, but it also happens on the individual scale. And this is how the consciousness expands and how the expression and the of the heart field expands to higher degrees of complexity. That's why you have these different ideas of what the chakra system actually looks like, because not everybody's chakra system looks the same. Your chakra system will actually shift along with your vibration. And the way that it shifts is as we activate inwards, going deeper into our heart space, so does the chakra system activate to a higher degree where we go into that period of chaos and then the chakra system finds a higher order of harmonic resonance. So again, I'd like to show not another video, but we'll go to this other screen. This was the geometry tool I was trying to show you last time, but I couldn't figure out how to share my screen. So here, we got it now. Hey, success. So here we have one fractal of our beingness. Let's say this is your seven chakras. Y'all can see this, right? You can see what I'm creating here. There's a square. You can see that? Okay, good.
Yes.
Great, thank you. So when we have our first seven chakras activated, this should be when we're becoming an adult, ideally speaking. Maybe it's later on in life. Doesn't really matter. But this is when the first chakras are activated. And then in order to activate higher fractals of oneself, we must go through that chaos, sort of like a death experience, a death of the ego experience, a death of the identity. And what happens is the heart sort of implodes in on itself, and we activate inwards, activating a fractal pattern inwards. When this fractal inside activates, what that does is activates an outer fractal. Oops. So when we activate that, going inwards and the heart implodes, all of a sudden we have access to two more fractals of ourself. One fractal going inward and one fractal expanding outward. And then to activate more, well, what that does, first of all, when we activate those two fractals, this first fractal shifts and detoxifies. and must be able to carry that higher vibration as well. So this is the complexity change. And then to activate a higher order, we must go inwards further. Sorry, not so accurate here, but you get the idea, yeah? When we activate a higher fractal inwards, again, the outer fractal activates. And so when we activate one, the heart implodes inwards and we become one with the planet. We activate further and we become one with the solar system. We activate further and we become one with the galaxy. We activate further, imploding the heart deeper inwards. We become one with the supercluster. Yes, and we keep going to infinitum. I don't know if there's an end. I don't think there is. I think there's a reason why God is infinite. Because this just keeps going. And we keep activating to higher and lower fractals of ourselves. And so this is just to illustrate the fractal nature of the activation of the chakra system and the increasing complexity as it activates. All right, I'm going to go back to our PowerPoint.
It's 4:40. You want to take the questions?
Yeah, why don't we take a pause and see what questions we have. Thank you. All right, can you read them? Because it's hard for me to check the questions while I'm having the presentation up. Are there any questions? Are there any questions written down?
I have a question.
Okay.
Did you experience any of these that you're talking about?
Oh yeah, that's how I am bringing this knowledge in. Because yes, I've most certainly experienced many implosions, heart implosions. Yes. Many people have. I'm not so special.
And where did you learn all of this?
Well, a lot of this is coming from my own higher self. A lot of it is coming from just my own experience and doing my best to look to see what others' experiences are and to better understand what my own experiences have been and why I'm experiencing what I'm experiencing. So all of this I've learned simply to explain what I've experienced. That's it.
Dawn has a question.
A lot of people have experienced this sort of thing. I'm not that special, really. I think it's a normal part of being human and a normal part of becoming aware that you are a spiritual being is this activation process.
And this is because of meditation?
Yes, partly. Good. Yes. It's partly because of meditation and partly, again, just because of that activation of the heart space from living by following your excitement. I believe following your excitement, following your passion, living from the heart spaces. And meditating is just a part of that lifestyle that activates the chakras. Yes. So it's a whole lifestyle. It's a whole way of being.
So Claire and Dawn, Praveen, Shiv?
Yeah, please.
Claire and Dawn say, would sounding the Bija mantra for a chakra help to balance it? Dawn?
It might. Again, if you have a overactivation of the chakra, you may not want to be using the Bija or the seed mantra too much. You may want to be activating other chakras. So it depends on if you have an underactivation or overactivation of the chakra. But yeah, especially if you have an underactivation of the chakra, then yeah, using the Bija mantra will really help.
Do you think it matters what frequency one chants the Bija mantra?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I mean, The Bija mantra is really only a mantra that's used to connect to that frequency. So you can say whatever you want if it's connecting to you to that frequency. You can, again, you have even these, you see these images, mandalas, right? These are also images that help to activate specific frequencies of the chakra. This is a mandala for the root chakra. One can simply focus on this mandala, just like focusing on the Bija mantra, or you can actually say the Bija mantra and bring this image up in your mind and focus on it, and this will activate the root chakra.
Do you think it's more activated? But what about balancing it? You think it would stimulate it, not necessarily balance it?
It depends on your intention, like you're saying. But yeah, generally, if you already have an overactive root chakra, you may not want to be doing something that's going to stimulate it. You may want to do something like a lot of exercise, for example, that will help in depleting that chakra of its energy and grounding the energy.
Now, Shiv,
yeah.
Like for example, we talked about Tourette. Joanne told us about Tourette syndrome, how it is.
Yeah.
And I'm sure Joanne sees a lot of patients with bipolar and all those kind of conditions in her specialty.
Yes.
Knowing all this, you know, all these chakras, if they're overstimulated, can cause Tourette or bipolar. Can we treat it by understimulating it or less stimulation of that? How do we prevent that? Can we do anything for that? That's the question.
Well, what you want to do is stimulate the chakras that will help to balance and counterbalance that chakra. So for example, if you have an overactive crown, what you want to do is stimulate the root.
Oh, I see.
This will help in balancing the crown. So you want to stimulate the root and you want to stimulate the heart. If you have an overactive root, right, you're going to want to stimulate the crown in the heart, right? Similarly, if you have an overactive pineal or third eye, right, you're going to want to stimulate the sacral.
How do you stimulate these?
How would these kids listen to all that?
You can stimulate them in various ways. Again, you can use the Bija mantra, you can use the mandala.
What is Bija mantra?
Oh, it's a seed mantra. For example, with the root, you have the mantra Lam, L-A-M, which is the traditional seed mantra. There are many seed mantras that you can use, but that traditional one is Lam. For the sacral, you have the traditional mantra of Vam, V-A-M. For the solar plexus, the traditional mantra is Ram. And then you have Ham, right? Basically, you have these different seed mantras that you can use. But I mean, there are many ways. You don't have to use mantra. You don't have to use visualization. You can even use your food. You can use exercise. You can use your lifestyle in order to change these. You can use manual manipulation. You can use self-myofascial release techniques to stimulate chakras. You can stimulate the chakras in many different ways, even eating red things, eating goji berries, you can stimulate the root chakra, right? Eating lots of oranges, you can stimulate the sacral chakra.
Shiv,
yes.
Can I ask you one question?
Yeah.
For example, Joanne would probably know that too. For example, in these psychiatric patients, you know, say with bipolar or something, instead of chakras, they keep giving them pills, right? So they,
yes.
what they're doing is they're
introducing a resistance to the chakra, which changes how the energy is flowing through the body. It creates other issues. So what they're doing is they're shifting where the issue is. Yes. It doesn't really solve the problem. It just shifts it.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Shiv, are you going to provide some sort of a guide as to what we can do for the different chakras and to recognize whether they're overstimulated or understimulated?
Yeah. I tried to give a little bit of information on how to recognize whether the chakras are over or understimulated. But yeah, in the future classes, we can talk about what you can do specifically to activate them. I had other stuff to talk about as well. But yeah, we can definitely go over that.
No, Joanne had a question. First thing is to know where you are currently.
Yes, definitely. That's important. Yeah, just being aware of it is the first step. Yes. That's where the heart comes into play. So you can observe without judgment.
Naveen says it's excellent. And then Joanne says, Joanne is saying, my question was answered. Okay, that's it. She's been answered. Yeah, okay.
I also have the question from Praveen Uncle. What is the significance of the shapes at the different frequencies?
Of the shapes?
Yeah. You know, you show
the symbols?
Nikola Tesla shapes?
Oh, the platonic solids, you mean?
Of the beads from the higher frequencies, as you, right? You show the video.
Oh, you mean
the sand particles. Sand particles.
Oh, yeah. Well, those are just... what they're doing is they have just turned up the frequency of a sound. And what you're actually seeing is you're visually seeing the vibration, the harmonic resonance pattern that's created by that sound. So you're actually just, you're seeing that frequency visually. And that's often like where you actually get these frequency patterns, like the number of petals on these flowers in each image, right, is coming from, they're there for a reason, right? And it's because of this frequency of each of these chakras.
In between those frequencies, I think you've written in your slides here, what happens is that there are regions with where the frequency is chaos, right? So
yes.
the patterns become chaotic.
Yes.
Above a certain frequency, but at a certain frequency, they become fractal-like. And
yes.
have these patterns. So what is the difference between the chaos and then the harmonic resonance that happens?
Well, the difference is what you're doing is you're just introducing a lot more energy. So the reason for the higher complexity of the pattern is because it allows for a larger amount of energy to be efficiently distributed through the system with less resistance.
Yeah, physically. So when you're meditating, what happens if you get into the chaotic regime?
Oh, it's okay. I mean, you can, what will happen is either you go into the chaos and you just come right back down to the resonance pattern that you started at, or you go into the chaos and if you are able to break through to the next resonance pattern, then it's sort of like you've been able to release something that has been preventing you from going further into your heart space.
Will entrainment be a better thing to get rid of this chaos? Meditation
is something that helps with, it just helps with the meditation. So you can entrain, let's say, like to the Schumann frequency, which is the frequency of the planet, by going to the beach, right? And you can entrain to that. The Schumann frequency is something that is variable, but you can also entrain to other things. For example, like traditionally, tribes will have drum circles or like shamanic circles, like where you're drumming and you're actually, what they're doing is they're creating an entrainment frequency of their own. And that entrainment also is one way of connecting to a higher order.
Yeah.
Higher frequency. Yeah. Entrainment is just one way of connecting to a deeper meditative space consciously.
Yeah.
But there are a lot of ways. You don't have to use entrainment, but yeah.
So what are the, if you have this metaphor of the beads of sand, right? What is that in the actual field? What is actually vibrate? So when you turn up the frequency, what is vibrating? What is the element that's vibrating? Is it an atom, or is it one part of the field?
It's everything. So everything is vibrating. Absolutely everything. There's nothing that's not vibrating. Actually, this brings me back to like your dad's question from last time, which was about the electron, right? Which actually one of my friends helped me to see the answer to that, which is another fractal level of self, which is again where we have the neutron, we have the proton, and we have the electron, right? The proton representing the soul, right? The neutron representing the body, and the electron representing the spirit, right? But we have nothing is actually not vibrating. Everything is vibrating. Even the body is constantly vibrating, and matter is constantly vibrating. It's not so physical. Matter itself is mostly space. So everything is vibrating, I guess, is the answer. And everything, when you're increasing the frequency, everything in the whole field is vibrating to that higher frequency and must basically come up to that frequency. That's why you get sort of detoxification reactions to an increase in vibration, right? Where there are certain things in the field that cannot actually even be in that higher vibration. So when you're increasing the vibration, there are certain memories, like traumatic memories, that may come up to be released because they can no longer be held in the field. They need to get out in order for you to actually go up to that higher level of resonance. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah, so like those memories may come up. Even physical things may come up and out, like toxins that are held in the body, because in order to get to that higher level of resonance, the body physically needs to shift and change and needs to let go of certain things that are holding it back resonance-wise. Does that make sense?
Yeah, but so usually, like in the sand particles, the sand is it's vibrating, but it's hard. Yeah, it's a little bit harder to define what the other field is. So a heart field, at every point in a space, there is some element of the heart field, I guess.
Yes.
So what that heart field is, maybe it's a magnetic field. I don't know, but
It's an electromagnetic field. Yeah.
Or it's a spiritual field.
Yeah, both.
But I mean,
it depends on sort of what language you're talking in. But yeah, I mean, the electromagnetic field is also the field of spirit. Yeah.
But I mean, if it's electromagnetic, then it's more like scientific, meaning material. It feels like electromagnetic feels like a spirit, right? If you have a magnetic field, you can feel your compass moving, right? If you have a compass, the compass moves direction, and that's showing you that we're all in a magnetic field of the earth, right?
Yeah.
But like in a spiritual field, it feels like, okay, maybe it's somewhere else or some in some other dimension or something. I don't even know.
Well, the what you're calling like the electromagnetic field, like it is coming from that spiritual essence, right? So the electromagnetic field is coming from, like, if you're talking about the electromagnetic field that's coming from your physical heart space, right? That we talk as Naveen, like that's Naveen, that's the fractal that we're talking about, right? Then that is actually coming from a black hole that's at the center of that heart space. And that black hole is what is connected to everything. And that's, I guess, what you're talking about as like the spiritual part, right? But like what you're talking about as like the physical field is actually coming from that space, and it's just a projection of that.
Joanne has a question.
Yeah.
Joanne, you want to address it yourself? Or do you want me to read it?
Yeah, actually, it's not a question. I just, I'll read what I wrote. As a student of your early teachings, I can say from my heart chakra to yours that your gift has truly developed, which I believe is a direct result of you practicing what you're teaching. In my observation, I would say you have cleared your throat chakra intensely.
Oh, thank you, Joanne. That's so sweet. Thank you so much. Yes, I've definitely changed a lot since we first met, and so have you. Definitely.
Yeah. Thank you.
Joanne is in the medical field, and she has known Shiv for last, how many years? 7 years, Joanne?
It's pretty close to 8.
That's amazing. Wow. Yeah. It's been a long time. Thank you, Joanne.
You're welcome.
And does anybody else have any other questions?
Forrest, are you there? Do you have any questions?
Is there something you can do which will balance all chakras at the same time?
Yes, actually. And that is going into the heart space. If you are able to go into the heart space intensely enough, that will balance all of the chakras, yes.
Benu has a question.
What I mean by that again is to really become that unconditional love and gratitude and appreciation and crystallize that as you. That is you. And when that is you, that balances all the chakras. When you become
Benu
that love.
Benu, speak up.
Oh, I can't hear you, Benu. I need to unmute yourself.
Benu says, to move this energy, you must first strengthen your chakra with yoga. So are planning to conduct those patterns or sequences with us to help move energy, something like that. I don't know. Benu, can you please
Do you wanna ask? Do you wanna say your question, Benu?
Well, to move from chakra to chakra.
Yes.
Which is energy.
Yes.
And those energy needs to, have in that certain frequency to go from one chakra to another chakra. And as far as I know, there are yoga sequences that you do to move those energy.
Yes.
So
yes, that can be very helpful. Yeah.
That is the first movement of energy, and then the meditation helps to promote it.
Yes.
So my question was, are you planning to conduct a class to go through those sequences?
You missed it today.
Every yoga class.
We did it today again. You missed it, Benu.
That's every yoga class. Yeah, every yoga class is about that. What we do is we first start by going into the heart space, getting that space of meditation. Yeah. Then we go through the chakras. We clear the energy field. We run a lot of breath, a lot of energy through the body to sort of clean the gutters, right? Activate. And then we sit in stillness and go into the heart space and activate with gratitude, love, and appreciation. And that's every yoga class.
Yes. And today we did a lot of lamb. It was rough.
Lamb.
We did a lot of exercises with lamb.
So a lot of beach mantras.
Yeah. It was tough. It was really tough.
They work well, yeah.
Okay, all right. Totally understand.
All right. Does anyone have any other questions? I was meaning to get, through more today, but hey, we'll get to other things next week. Isn't that always how it is?
Thank you, Shiv.
Thank you, Shiv.
Turn off the sharing.
It's perfect. Thank you, Shiv.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Shiv.
Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Thank you, Shiv.
Hey.
Thank you, Shiv.
I'll see you all next week.
Sure.
We'll get two more.
That was a good...
That was a good exposition, yeah.
Good. Glad you enjoyed it.
Thanks, Chef.
Thank you.